This ghost town is a unique crossover for my channel, because on my channel, I like to focus both on maritime stories, such as ocean liner disasters, for example, the SS Atlantic, and also ghost towns. And here we have a small town, which is really more or less forgotten. There's not much to see. There's not too many people who come out here to explore. Much of this is on private property. But this is a crossover, because two passengers of that shipwreck disaster, which I've covered extensively, were coming out to this town. And unfortunately, their travels were abruptly cut short on the morning of April 1st, 1873. The town's history began in 1860, when Hiram Hughes and his son were looking for stray cattle in the hills to the south of the current town site. They discovered gold, and later copper, on what is now called Hog Hill, and once they staked their claim, began establishing a town along the creek below the hill. This little town, which they called Grasshopper City, drew in miners and laborers, but later the same year, another, larger strike was made a few miles away, drawing much of the attention away from Grasshopper City. However, a general store was established here, and a small town grew around it. Grasshopper City expanded through the 1860s, boasting a hotel, restaurant, saloons, billiard halls, and even a stagecoach station. All around the border of the town sprang up several ranches, which hired dozens of ranch hands, many of whom were immigrants moving to the United States and moving out westward. One of these men was a man named John Henry Umpleby. He was born in Surrey, England, in 1822, and moved to California in 1849 as one of the famous 49ers, but we'll get back to his story in a minute. America's westward expansion saw railroads, stage routes, and telegraph lines going up rapidly, crossing the desert and reaching out to the Pacific. In the late 1860s and early 1870s, the telegraphs reached the city of Sonora to the east of Grasshopper, and were set up from there to Stockton to the west of Grasshopper. The telegraph line went right through Grasshopper City, connecting it to the rest of America. Now by this point, thousands of towns in America already had the telegraph, and it wasn't much more than a wonderful modern convenience. But for a small town where the most exciting feature was the insects that occasionally hopped by, the town of Grasshopper thought the telegraph was the best thing since sliced bread, which actually hadn't even been invented yet. So forget grasshoppers. They changed the name of the town now to Telegraph City. It's funny though that in both names, they called themselves a city, even though their population never really surpassed 100 or 200 people. Telegraph City also had its own post office from 1862 to 1894. In 1872, John Umpleby, working on one of the ranches in Telegraph City, received word that his niece, a 17-year-old girl in England named Lillian Davidson, was ill, likely with tuberculosis. Her mother, Lauriston, John's sister, was widowed only a year or two prior, and had no reason to stay in England anymore. It was agreed that Lauriston and Lillian would pack up, leave England, and immigrate to the United States, hoping that the drier climate of California would ease Lillian's condition. Lauriston's deceased husband was Captain Alexander Davidson of the brig William Stovold, whom she met and became engaged to during a voyage aboard the vessel. Even widowed, Lauriston was financially secure for the time being, and booked first-class passage for her and her daughter on one of the most advanced and luxurious ships of the 1870s, the White Star Liner SS Atlantic, departing Liverpool, England on March 20th, 1873. In their possession were a Bible, a banknote for £800, and two silver spoons, as well as a letter directing Lillian to go straight to Telegraph City and meet her uncle should anything happen to her mother. Meanwhile, John Umpleby secured a place for his sister and niece to stay at in the town, and made arrangements to get them established in the United States, likely even securing temporary employment for them on the ranch. Now, John and Lauriston grew up on a farm together, a farm that Lauriston was actually named for, so I'm sure Lauriston would have been useful around the ranch as well. And once the SS Atlantic arrived in New Jersey, the mother and daughter would board a train with the Erie Railroad and then make their way across the continent. However, a series of miscommunications aboard the SS Atlantic led the captain to believe that they were low on coal after sailing against a storm for several days, and he diverted the ship to Halifax, Nova Scotia, where they would restock. The ship approached Nova Scotia in the early hours of April 1st, when the stubborn officer on watch refused to wake the captain as directed, believing that he was capable of bringing the ship in on his own. He was wrong, unfortunately. The ship was off course and rammed hard onto the rocky shore west of Halifax. The lights went out, the ship beached, and was battered by the surf. The Davidson women had no warning. They were thrown from their beds by the impact and scrambled in the darkness to dress and grab their belongings. They did not even make it out of their cabin before the ship flooded and their part of the ship went under the freezing water less than 10 minutes after impact. The disaster of the SS Atlantic is one of the worst disasters of the North Atlantic in the 1800s and the worst wreck for the White Star Line until the sinking of the Titanic in 1912. The bodies of the Davidsons were recovered from the wreckage, and the coroner reported they suffocated in their saloon-class cabin. The spoons, banknote, and Bible were passed on to the family, and a photograph was taken of their grave. It's this photograph that brought me to Telegraph City. I've studied the wreck of the SS Atlantic for years, and was always intrigued by the story of the Davidson women, and further baffled by this grave photo. Online records will show that the Davidsons were buried in Halifax at Camp Hill Cemetery. Indeed, some of the victims of the Atlantic are there, including the purser and that stubborn officer who doomed the ship, but this grave is not. I've searched it repeatedly, and the cemetery administration confirms that there is no record of this burial. I talked to Shrouded Veterans, a nonprofit that tracks down unmarked graves of U.S. military veterans and has also done work with the SS Atlantic, and they were able to confirm that the Davidson bodies were not buried in Halifax, and as of a month after the sinking, their bodies were still waiting to be claimed. Nothing beyond that, however. Now, would family in England have brought them back? Or would John in Telegraph City have brought them out there to complete their journey? We have absolutely no idea. In fact, if you look at the photograph, the foliage in the background does kind of look like the trees and brush that you would find out in California. So that's why we're here, to search the cemeteries in person. Before we do, I wanted to explore the remains of the town. The most impressive ruin of Telegraph City are the foundations of the town's main barn and adjoining windmill. It's hard to date these structures, but they appeared in this photograph from circa 1925. Even though the windmill has fallen victim to target practice, we can see that it's an air motor windmill. The company of Air Motor of Chicago began selling windmills in 1888. Now, it's hard to pinpoint the date of this one, but suffice to say that after at least 100 years, it's still standing in the wind and still pumping water into an abandoned cattle trough.
It's very silent here. There's no sound of wind. You do hear the birds in the trees, and occasionally you hear this rusty old windmill spinning. But other than that, it's very still. We're out of earshot of the highway down the road, and it's just very lonely.
An iconic feature of the Telegraph City ghost town site are the miles and miles of stone walls that streak across the rolling hills. These were built under the supervision of a Welshman named Jimmy Sykes, who built these walls all around the neighboring towns as well. He built them for all different purposes, but in the specific case of Telegraph City, the ones that we're looking at are meant to mark off the borders of the old ranches dating back to the 1880s, specifically the Beardsley, Parks, and Shoemaker ranches. It kept the livestock in, and the idea was that it would also keep the wildfires out. Some of these ranches are still active, and no doubt these 140-year-old walls are still proving useful. Granted, there are still walls in Wales dating back to the Roman period that are still in use, so leave it to a Welshman to build something like this. Now, there's also a local urban legend about someone named the Chicken Boy, a disturbed local who used to haunt the area at night. Now, residents of the nearby town will swear that this is true and that there's nothing supernatural about it, it's just a disturbed individual, but finding any further solid information about this story was next to impossible. Now, getting back to the reason I'm here. I've come across the country to see if these graves of the two women are here in Telegraph City. Telegraph City has three small cemeteries in it. One has a single headstone, and the other two have about a half a dozen. These are private, family cemeteries, and we can confirm that the Davidsons are not buried in them. Now, in 1899, John Umpleby died in the nearby town of Eugene, only a couple miles to the southwest. The logical place for him to be buried is in Eugene's cemetery, the St. Joseph Cemetery. St. Joseph's Cemetery was a sparse, windswept graveyard, a contrast of old, faded headstones and ones as recent as only a few years ago.
You can actually see that this is the base of an old wooden cross, similar to the ones that we see in those corners over there. I'm not seeing any stone that looks like the one belonging to the two women, and I'm not seeing John.
Many of the graves indicated the end of a very long journey, people born overseas who picked up their roots and migrated several times.
Well, that's it for St. Joseph's Cemetery. I looked at pretty much every grave in here, and there's no sign of any of that family.
Having struck out at four cemeteries, we tried the large cemetery in nearby Farmington.
I never thought that these stones might be hollow, unless this is not an original one. Died 1895, 50 years old, born in England. We have some stones dating back to the 1880s, so that does put us in the right time frame for the Atlantic disaster and John, who died in 1899. Here's an 1899 one. So this is definitely an active cemetery at that time period.
Though we knew there was only a slim chance that the graves would be there, it was worth checking out since this was the largest cemetery in the area. But still, no luck. After 5 years of searching, the location of the graves of Lauriston and Lillian Davidson are still unknown. Are they perhaps back in England, in a family plot? Perhaps with their extended family in Australia or New Zealand? Perhaps their headstone is gone and the grave will never be found. Maybe someday we'll have an answer to this. But regardless, the search for them has brought us to the modest little ghost town of Telegraph City, one that very few explorers would ever bother to go out of their way to see, and one that otherwise may never have had its story preserved. The Davidson ladies may not have been able to reach Telegraph City, but as a symbolic gesture, I brought a handful of artifacts from my collection, artifacts recovered from the wreckage of the SS Atlantic in 1873, so that at least something indirectly connected with them has finally completed their journey.
If you enjoy my work and would like to support me on Patreon, because these videos are quite costly to make, please do check it out at patreon.com/parttimeexplorer. And don't forget to subscribe, I cover a lot of ghost towns and shipwreck stories. Thank you very much for watching.
A huge thank you to my supporters on Patreon, especially Marlo Perez, Kaiser Wilhelm der Zweite, Trent Greger, Zach Richards, Tom Shavada, Donald Anderson, Cody Henricks, Rob M., Amos Mayhew, Corey Andrews, Dakota Charbonneau, Nicholas Musella, Zolt Bognar, Colt Tannick, Eric Morang, and Sophie Baber.